Good morning and welcome to First Baptist Church. It's so good to see you out this morning and to know that not only you that are here with us in the sanctuary, that we can worship our Lord and God together, but also that those that are at home and might be watching either now live on Facebook or later as it comes on the YouTube channel, that you are with us and that you can join us. So it's a beautiful morning, a beautiful fall morning. It's cool, but the sun is nice and bright out there. So let us open our worship this morning with the Psalm of David, Psalm 34. I will extol the Lord at all times. His praise will always be on my lips. I will glory in the Lord. Let the afflicted hear and rejoice. Glorify the Lord with me. Let us exalt his name together. I sought the Lord, and he answered me. He delivered me from all my fears. Those who look to him are radiant. Their faces are never covered with shame. This poor man called, and the Lord heard him. He saved him out of all his troubles. The angel of the Lord encamps around those who fear him, and he delivers them. Taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the one who takes refuge in him. Welcome this morning as we worship our Lord.
In Psalm 103 we read, bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless his holy name. Would you please stand?
Amen. into or called to worship? Are there people who have influenced your life in negative ways?
There are people who only want to see the sorrow and sadness.
Are there people who have tried to bring you into despair?
There are people so entrapped in their own misery that they cannot think in other ways.
Come to the Lord, whose brightness and truth will give you new light and insight.
Bring us to your light, Lord Jesus, that we may be strengthened to withstand the darkness and bring that light to others.
Amen. Let us pray. Oh, Father God, open our eyes, Lord. Help us to see Jesus as he reaches out to heal our blindness. Help us to let go of all those things that keep us in darkness. This day, as your word is proclaimed, let our hearts and souls respond with joy. Transform our lives to do your will. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Charles Gabriel, the composer of the hymn, I Stand Amazed, captures the awe of Christ that we have through his suffering. Luke 22:41-44 reads, and he was withdrawn from them about a stone's cast, and kneeled down and prayed, saying, Father, if thou be willing, remove this cup from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but thine be done. And being in agony, he prayed more earnestly, and his sweat was, as it were, great drops of blood falling down to the ground. Would you stand and worship with me, singing, I Stand Amazed?
Thank you. take care of it. Our scripture reading today is from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 10, verses 46 to 52. And what we'll hear today is about a blind man who had nothing except great faith. Then they came to Jericho. As Jesus and his disciples, together with a large crowd, were leaving the city, a blind man, Bartimaeus, which means son of Timaeus, was sitting by the roadside begging. When he heard that it was Jesus of Nazareth, he began to shout, "Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me." Many rebuked him and told him to be quiet, but he shouted all the more, "Son of David, have mercy on me." Jesus stopped and said, "Call him over." So they called to the blind man, "Cheer up, on your feet. He's calling you." Throwing his cloak aside, he jumped to his feet and came to Jesus. "What do you want me to do for you?" Jesus asked him. The blind man said, "Rabbi, I want to see." "Go," said Jesus, "your faith has healed you." Immediately, he received his sight and followed Jesus along the road. May the Lord bless the reading of this, his holy word.
Sermon is entitled Son of Honor. When my children were small, we would go out, usually in November, to stand with the crowds in the freezing weather to watch the Santa Claus parade. People would line the streets and watch as the bands passed by, as well as all the different floats which had been decorated to announce that Christmas was just around the corner. Of course, the highlight was to see Santa Claus on his magic sled come close enough to see. In the meantime, candies flew in your direction. People dressed as elves walked past and handed out flyers, and then the great expected event appeared around the corner. And the Merry Christmas was hollered out from the height of the last thing the children would see that night, Santa Claus and all his reindeer. It was exciting. But it was nothing compared to the parade that Jesus and his disciples were in on this day. The streets were lined and filled with pilgrims coming from every direction and heading to the holy city. Jesus' reputation had gone ahead of him, and perhaps once there some could catch a glimpse of him, the one that some called and said was the Messiah. Perhaps they would see a miracle, or hear words of wisdom such as none other spoke, or even hear him and his enemies get into a word game, one in which Jesus was always the winner. On the sidelines is a beggar Mark has named, Bartimaeus, blind Bartimaeus to be exact. He is the son of Timaeus, for Bar means just that, the son of. He is a beggar, an outcast, an outsider. Yet, ironically, his name also has another meaning. For Timaeo, his father's name means honor. Therefore, Bartimaeus is the son of honor. His name stands at odds with his circumstances, for he is the one who lives on the margins of society. Jesus, however, shows him respect and restores his sight so that he can reclaim the honor found in his name. Jesus will do that for you too. If you are his beloved, which we are all here, you are his friend, his brother, and his disciple. Never forget that that is who you are in him. But there sat a blind beggar, as most that were blind would do. Begging in that day was regarded charitably and in that culture. And it would have been an unpleasant experience by all standards. But there he sat on the roadside and you can imagine his difficulty in understanding and knowing what was happening around him. The noisy road, no friends to help him, yet in all this chaos, he somehow knew that Jesus was there. And he began to call out, "Jesus, you son of David, have mercy on me." Now, this is a messianic title, one up until this point that Jesus had been trying to keep quiet. Till then, his time had not yet come, but now it has, for he is on the way to Jerusalem, ready to confront the religious establishment, ready to die. So Jesus does not rebuke Bartimaeus for calling out in this way. Instead, Jesus stops in his tracks. But I want you to take good note of Bartimaeus here, for this would have been the prime time for begging. He could be just raking in the dollars here, for pilgrims on the way to the holy city could be expected to be generous. Beggars would and did depend on days like this for most of their income. Like the stores today who start focusing on Halloween and Christmas paraphernalia much before the actual season. We would find no fault in Bartimaeus, though, if he was content with his circumstances and begged for money. But see, instead of focusing on where he is in life, and that this is just the way it is, his focus is on where he can be healed. He shouts out that he has heard Jesus, has been listening for him, in fact, and is determined to get his attention. He wants the help he believes Jesus is able to offer. See, too often we are focused on where we are instead of where we could be. This is who I am, we say. Instead of looking for the healing and asking for it, we focus on today and, well, this is just how it is. Jesus does not call us to stay who we were when we found him. Jesus wants us to be healed, and if we are aware or not of what we should and could be healed from, then he wants us to do what Bartimaeus does, call out and ask. He will show us and lead us. He will heal us. Now, in this crowd, we know too that many people tried to shut Bartimaeus down and told him to be quiet. "We're having a good time," they say, "and you're making a lot of racket. Sit there and just stop shouting." Bart, a short form of his name, Bart, won't listen to them though, for he continues to cry out because his future, his life, is at stake. Perhaps yours is too. There are and may be times when you may be told to be quiet. God can't heal your background. Maybe you even say this to yourself. "I'm damaged by my parents, my boyfriend or girlfriend, my husband or my wife, or the company that hired me or fired me." Or we hear other voices from both our inside and the outside that say, "I am, you are this way forever." And I'm going to tell you right now that those voices are lies. Because never does God call us to himself only to leave us the same as when we answered him. God will never not challenge us to grow and become more like Christ. Never. We can shut him out. We can focus on our circumstances and make the best of them, like Bart could have done here. We can stay stuck. But that is not where God wants us to be. Instead, Bart cries out, and amidst the noise of the crowd, Jesus hears his cry. You see, Jesus' ears are always attuned to the marginal, to those who are sick both in heart and body. And he calls them to himself. And Jesus calls out to those who are obstructing the man's claim to healing instead to become his helping hands. The stiff hands become pliable hands, ready to serve one another. This is what Jesus calls us to be, always to be, pliable hands that will help others come to a place of healing through the power and the grace of Jesus Christ. And just as suddenly for us, as this man who was an outcast, the one who was on the wayside, is center stage, and Jesus asks what he can do for him, thereby giving him dignity. Today, he is asking you the same thing. What can I do for you? Take a moment in your mind. Still the voice that says, no way, he can't do it for me. And in faith, ask to be healed of your past, of what might be obstructing you and your future. What is holding you back today? We all remember that Mark wrote about James and John, who asked to sit at Jesus' right and his left when they entered the kingdom. In the past few weeks, we made mention of those verses, though we have not read them outright. Here, Bartholomew's petition is very different from James and John's petition. They had asked to be seen. Bartimaeus asks to see. Not for honor, but for vision. Not to be superior to others, but to become ordinary himself. Not to rule over others, but to join them in their experience of a normal life. When we ask with the same disposition, do we think Jesus will not hear and answer? You see, like Bartimaeus, we have to cast away our cloak, our past, what we may cling to as our valuable belonging. Don't tell me that we don't cling to a bad past as valuable. People do so all the time. Some people think, why be healed when I can get sympathy whenever I mention my past? Or how about these comments? I'm comfortable. I'm accustomed to it. I cannot change it. It's just the way it is. The way I am. Well, no, you cannot change it. Neither can I. But Jesus surely can. And Jesus still heals. Jesus healed Bartimaeus with a word. When Jesus raised the little girl, he touched her first. When he healed the deaf and mute man, he first put his fingers in his ears and he touched his tongue. Here, Jesus simply speaks the word or the words. Your faith has made you well. And immediately, the man is made well and he can see. This is not the only time that we read these words, your faith has made you well. We hear them when the woman with the bleeding disorder came to Jesus. We hear them when one of the 10 lepers came back to thank Jesus for his healing. Bartimaeus is saved. He begins the road alongside it and ends the story as a follower of Jesus. Now, I'm not saying that strong faith will heal you. Those aren't the words that I'm saying. And if you aren't healed, your faith is weak. The church has said that far too many times and has hurt the outcast even further. What I want us to take away from today's sermon is how faith is manifested, nurtured, and also can be stunted within a community. Various characters play different roles here. Bartimaeus with his needs and his prophetic insights. Jesus with his compassion and his grace. The crowd with its determination to keep Bartimaeus both blind and invisible. And others with the opportunity to guide him to Jesus with the hopeful words, take courage, get up, he's calling you. May we all community of encouragement and hope, helping to bring the broken, the lost, the unsaved toward their namesake as a son or daughter of honor, rather than remaining as a blind Bartimaeus. May those who need healing come to the one great healer, Jesus Christ. And when he asks what he can do for them, what he can do for you, may they answer in faith, heal me. Heal me so I can see clearly. Let us come to our Lord and Savior in prayer. Oh, Father God, you are so good and merciful to us, we who do not deserve a thing from you. Yet you look upon us, and you love us, and you care for us, and you hold us, and you heal us. Why is it, Lord, that we are sometimes afraid to cry aloud our need to you? We sit in our darkness and we cry and complain about the dire circumstances that have overtaken us. Yet when given the opportunity to approach the Savior who offers us light and healing, we cower in the darkness, holding on to our cloak, not daring to believe that healing and light are possible for us. The darkness of our soul invades our lives. Colors our attitudes and determines our actions. Lord Jesus, come, come, come and shine your light, not only on us, but in us and eventually through us. Break the barriers we have erected against peace, freedom, healing, and hope. Bathe us in the light of love. We shall become bearers of that incredible light for others who dwell in darkness. Help us, Lord, to see clearly with enlightened eyes the healing power you hold out for each one of us. Show us, Lord, how you were there in the moments of our life which brought us trauma, which when we reflect upon them tear open old wounds, which are reflected through us when we are feeling stressed and stretched, and above all, which display for us how we have not let you in to make the truth known to us. Oh, Jesus, you promised to never leave us, and if we truly believe that, then you were right there beside us when our searing pain was taking place. So show us now, Lord, and remove the lies from inside our hearts which cause us to believe what the enemy of our soul tells us. Lord Jesus, you are the truth and the way and the light. Father God, we pray for those amongst us that are sick, that need your touch. We pray for those amongst us that are stuck in their ways, for your light to shine on them and in them. We pray for us to reach out and take a hold of the healing power which you hold freely for us. Father, we pray for those that grieve, for those that are lonely, for those that are depressed and sick at heart. We think today specifically about Susan, whose friend Billy passed away, and pray for your comforting power in her life and in her heart. We thank you, Lord, that you offer us a place, a home of eternity, where we can spend the rest of our time with you, glorying in who you are as our Savior and Lord. Father, as we receive light from you and light from Jesus Christ, your Son, this day, give us the courage and the confidence to reach out in compassion and service in your name to those that also need your touch. We ask this in
Please stand as we are closing hymn, Amazing Grace. Go now, beloved, and serve.